Welcome to the first installment of our new departmental webisode series. Whether you're a student in Intro to History, History 290, an alum, or someone just out there in YouTube land who stumbled across us, my name is Chris Gehrz. I'm professor of history at Bethel University and your host for Past and Presence. So past and presence. Well, past makes sense. We'll come back to it. But certainly, we want to think about how the past inspires us, challenges us, convicts us, moves us, teaches us. What about presence, though? We don't often think about history and the present or history and the future. Partly, this should get us to think about the purpose of an education in the history department at a place like Bethel. We're not just filling your head with knowledge about past events. We're shaping you for the person that you're going to be and become. We're getting you to think about what are your virtues? What are your values? What is your character? What moves you? What makes you grieve? What makes you joyful? We're also going to give you skills that you're going to use in a variety of careers. Over the course of this webisode series, you'll meet a lot of our alumni who are doing everything from teaching and law, working in libraries, teaching English in China, working in the business world. And there are plenty of others, too. For example, this is Jeff Nelson. He's a 1987 Bethel history grad, went to law school, and now works as a major league umpire. He's umpired World Series, League Championship Series, the All-Star Game. It's not a common outcome for our department, but it suggests that we're preparing people for a wide diversity of careers, and hopefully you'll get a better sense of that if you're a student as we go along in the semester. But I think we also mean presence a little bit more abstractly and a little bit more maybe metaphysically. The Christian scholar James Davison Hunter suggests that Christians ought to exert a faithful presence in the world. Wherever God calls you, however God gifts and equips you, what does it mean to be a faithful follower of Jesus Christ? And maybe just very humble careers. This isn't necessarily positions of power and influence. And so what are we doing in the department to prepare you to exert that faithful presence wherever you are? So that's presence. What about past? And here we're going to get to our first discussion. Most of our episodes are going to feature a discussion with myself and a couple of other faculty about some theme that we'll pick up in the class the following Monday night. So what does the past mean for a place like Bethel University? Well, if you think about it, we all use the past in different ways. That's really not unusual. We do it to make sense of our identity. Whether we're individuals or families or organizations, the past is sometimes useful to us. It can inspire us. It can help us understand where we come from and where we're going. But I think historians use the past in a particular way. And so that's where we're going to start the class, where we're going to start the series. Thinking about the ways that historians use the past. What is the discipline of history, and how is it maybe different than from somehow other folks use the past? So we'll start with our first conversation involving some faculty, and then come back and see a little bit more of this present, the Bethel campus. So one of my favorite parts of doing this class is that as part of the webisodes, we get to have conversations with other members of the faculty, and in a sense have this intro course taught by the entire group of professors in the history department. We'll actually bring our TAs in for at least one conversation. And we'll start with a really simple question, which is, what do we do as historians? We'll dive into aspects of this, but I'm just opening, think definitionally. Like, let's assume the past, first of all, is like everything that's happened in time and space up to the present moment, including the beginning of that question. What is history then in relation to the past? Or what do historians do with the past that's distinctive?
Well, I think it's, I'm sort of more of a humanities person than a social science person. Mm-hmm. So for me, it's telling a compelling story about the past. And then I suppose where the social science part comes in is telling the story as faithfully and as accurately as possible, using research methods to do that, and using good sources versus not so good sources. That's where I'd start.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I sometimes ask students if they think history is more of a science or right. an art or a literature. Amy, do you?
Yeah, I think it's a combination of those. Based on what AnneMarie said. I think for me, the goal is to always say as accurately as possible, how can we involve as many voices of the people who actually experienced what it is that we're studying as we can. There's challenges to that though, mm-hmm. because sometimes when you're focusing too much on personal experience, you have to think about a person's station in life, their own bias as to what they're experiencing. So I sort of feel that it has to be that combination because you're using certain types of social science methods. But then you also have to take into account that these are flawed human beings the same way that we are, you know, and I think that's something where I've really become more cognizant of that in the last few years, of saying, as much as I want the personal narrative to be what maybe I use the most, at the same time, I have to be critical of that.
And at a certain point, there's just the problem of capacity. I mean, we can't actually capture all of this, right?
No.
And so another layer that I know John Field will talk about in the book they're reading is that history is an act of interpretation. It's not just the facts. It's impossible, first of all. You can capture all of them, and you have to do something. You have to make meaning out of them. And so that's maybe part, you know, story is a way to do that, but there are other ways to do it as well. Another kind of past-related category that might come to mind when you think about what history is would be memory. Do these overlap? Are they distinct categories? How do you think history and memory relate to each other?
Boy, that's a good question. I think there is actually a whole field that looks at the way in which we memorialize or remember something. So even the way that we've done that or commemorate things, that has changed over time and is informed actually by the present. So they think there is a way in which history and memory overlap, but you can actually study the history of memory, because history is fantastic.
Well, I remember when I first came here, our website, the kind of tagline was like, a society, like, you know, just like an individual that can't remember its past has no identity, a society that can't remember the past. So it was almost like history equals collective memory. And I think to some extent that's true. Like, we'll talk in class about the relationship of history and identity personally and communally, but I mean, it's like I often use a quotation from a European historian named Tony Judd, who says that memory is self-reinforcing. Like, often societies tell them stories they want to hear. History is actually disenchanting, disruptive, and charring. And like, he's okay with that. I mean, that puts us in awkward spots sometimes.
No, and I think it is a combination of both. I mean, I remember having a conversation with you last spring, where I came to you and I said, you know, that a student had said to me at the end of a class, gosh, you know, after the last 3 years of studying history, I just sometimes feel so down and so depressed and so disillusioned. And I remember being kind of, you know, I mean, I didn't like that was his response, but at the same time, you know, you and I had a conversation that was sort of, that probably means we're doing our job well, because then it isn't all about memorializing or celebrating based on memories that we want to have, but that we've allowed as much as we can certain types of truth to come through, that if it was just focused on the memory aspect, would not be accurate. So in a way, I think we have to help students balance both of those. I mean, there are times where you are depressed and feel disenfranchised or disillusioned, but that actually means you're probably doing good work.
Is there an extent to which history can or should be inspiring, though? I mean,
I think it can be both. I mean, I think you can, though, that you can be both depressed and inspired at the same time, because it's the depression that hopefully, I mean, we can leave you depressed, but hopefully there's still that. And now what do you do with it? How can you then use that to motivate you? And I think that's part of our job, is to help students determine how do you use that to then become a launching pad to motivate you to keep going or to keep looking or keep investigating or to try to change certain types of things.
Well, I think that's just being faithful to a very foundational Christian perspective,
yes.
which
mm-hmm.
is, you know, there's evidence in history of creation and there's evidence in history of the fall.
Mm-hmm.
And seeing both should help us feel like we're part of the redemptive process.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And yet we remain hopeful, because that's what we're called to
Absolutely.
Do.
Absolutely.
So,
okay.
Johnny, get your gun. Take it on the run. Hear them calling you and me, every son of liberty. Hurry right away, no delay, go today. Make your daddy glad to have had such a lad. Tell your sweetheart not to pine, we'll be proud her boys in line. Over there, send the word over there. That the Yanks are coming, the drums, coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer, send the word, to beware. We'll be older, we're coming over, and we won't come back till it's over there. Johnny, get your gun, get your gun, get your gun. Johnny, show the hun, you're a son of a gun. Hoist the flag and let her fly. Yankee Doodle, do or die. Pack your little kit, show your grit, do your bit. Yankees to the ranks, from the towns and the tanks. Make your mother proud of you, and the old red, white, and blue. Over there, send the word over there. That the Yanks are coming, the Yanks are coming. The drum, drum coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer. Send the word, we'll be where. We'll be over, we'll coming over, and we won't come back till it's over, over there.
Welcome to the glamorous confines of AC's Second. This is the longtime home of the History Department, where its faculty office, including Ruben Rivera. This is AC 205. Ruben's been here since the late 1990s and teaches a variety of classes ranging from church history to minorities in America to Latin American civilizations. You'll see lots more from Ruben as the semester goes on. We share this space with a few other people, including the members of the Political Science Department. We've had a long relationship with the Poli-Sci Department, a lot of cross-listed classes, double majors, and so you'll probably get to know some of them as well. We'll come back to our conversation about the nature of what historians do and how they use the past in a little while. But in each of these episodes, we also want to introduce you to faculty or alumni, or in this case, an alum who is a faculty member, Diana Magnuson. This is AC 206, Diana's office. Diana was a graduate of Bethel College herself, went to the University of Minnesota to finish her doctorate, and teaches American history, including classes in women's history, 18th, 19th century America. She's also the archivist of the Baptist General Conference in Bethel University. The archives are up the hill in the seminary library. And so we're actually going to interview Diana in her element in the archives and talk to her about how her training here at Bethel helped prepare her for work both as a professor and as an archivist.
I am a Bethel graduate, 1988.
I'm a 1999 Bethel grad.
I'm a teacher at Minnehaha Academy.
I am the pastor of worship and adult ministries here at Church of the Cross.
Mutuality editor and publications coordinator.
I work as an attorney in the business and corporate practice.
English Language Institute, China, in China.
Library director at the College of St. Scholastica.
I'm a history professor at Bethel University.
I was a history major.
I was a Bethel history major.
I was a history major.
I was a history major.
I was a history major.
History major.
I was a history major.
I was a history major.
I'm Diana Magnuson. I'm a history professor at Bethel University. I was also a history major and political science major here at Bethel. I am also the director of archives at the History Center of the Baptist General Conference. Well, I don't have a favorite memory. I was thinking it's more like Monet, my memories. It's kind of blurry and fuzzy and things run together. But my impressions of what I remember of that time are just the camaraderie of students, the friends that I had in my history classes. And I don't have any real specific memories of courses. Margie Koch was a huge favorite. She was a women's historian, the only woman historian I'd had. I loved her class, the history of women in the Muslim world, and just her approach to teaching the course was new and fresh and inspirational. So that's a favorite memory. I don't think I came to Bethel thinking, okay, I'm going to be here 5 years and then I'm out of here. I really saw it kind of like a union and that it was a place that I had planned to stay and grow and develop. I think even at that time I had an understanding that it would take a long time to become who I needed to be effective. And I was already grateful for, I knew that Bethel was going to give me that space to grow. So I don't think I intended to leave. Boy, I don't know. I think make friends with people in other departments. I think that's been really healthy for me. I would say to myself, do that earlier than I did it. I think I sort of found my way to that. Make friends with people in other departments, keep reading a lot, keep dialoguing with people outside of Bethel University to stay fresh and invigorated and have new ideas. I guess those would be things I would say to myself. I think what I find most energizing or fulfilling about teaching, and I guess I don't really think of it as teaching, I think of it as providing opportunities for students to engage material, and maybe that's teaching, but I love engaging the lives of Americans who have gone before us, and I just find it a profound privilege to do that. These stories of Americans, especially people who are on the fringe, who in their time weren't important, they weren't considered significant, yet for whatever reason, their story has been preserved, and now we study it, and they're sort of the person that we look to as an experience of that era that we study. I just think that's remarkable. And it's profoundly moving to me every single time I get to do it, to look at a person's life. Maybe it's a person who we know their name, but maybe it's not. And that's just really moving to me. So that's something that I really appreciate. That's what energizes me about teaching, is bringing these stories to other people, to other students. So, well, I sort of fell into this position as director of archives. It isn't something I trained for, although I had a lot of experience as a grad student working, doing research in archives, so in a variety of types of archival settings. So I think that prepared me for this place. It gives me an appreciation for the importance of preserving materials for researchers who will come after. And you really have to think about how are people going to be able to find this stuff and access it? And that's been really exciting to work with Kent Gerber, the digital librarian. So I think that, I mean, has clear connections. Students who might be interested in doing this kind of work, I think it's been great that I can present that to our students in our department in a way that wasn't present when I was a student. And students mostly think that if you're a history major, you have to go into law, or you have to go into teaching or selling insurance. Seems like something that a lot of our students do. But when the students come here and see how they can use skills of analysis, synthesis, writing, and just interacting with these primary source materials, they see it as an opportunity. We've had, in the last several years, my last three students in particular have gone on to do graduate work in records management and archival studies, museumology, and it's opened up a whole world to them that they didn't realize existed, and in this new digital era is really, really becoming important and significant in a lot of ways. So it's like asking me, who's your favorite child? I tell each one of my children, you're my favorite. It kind of depends on what I'm teaching. Everybody knows that my favorite historical monograph is Laurel Thatcher Ulrich's A Midwife's Tale. I tell that to students when I teach American Beginnings, but I also talk about it in my women's history course. I love that book because I love the way she uses the primary source of Martha Ballard's diary. I love the thematic way that she explores women's lives in that era. I love the way she's interdisciplinary. I think it's such a great tool for showing students how you do history. There's also a PBS documentary that's a docudrama. I don't know if you've seen it, but the docudrama portrays Martha Ballard's life, but then interspersed with that is our interviews with Laurel Thatcher Ulrich, and she shows you how she organized this vast amount of material and how she made things come alive. She shares her serendipitous moments about things in earlier parts of the diary that didn't make sense to her, or she didn't really notice. And then as she got more immersed in Martha's world and Martha's life, she realized what Martha was referring to. So that it's just really exciting. But I love literature of the period. My 19th century class, A New Nation, we use mostly literature of the era as our primary source. And students are often sort of surprised by that because they think, well, this is literature. I'm like, yeah, but it was written in this period. It's a primary source. This person is exploring issues of their time. What sorts of questions are they asking? What are the emotions that are evoked in this period? So I love using literature. I love the 19th century, the flowering of American literature. I like American Beginnings because we can explore a lot of different types of primary sources that students don't think of as primary sources. I love the modern period because we can use modern literature, but also there's so much more media available. So we use a lot of film that is a primary source, you know, film clips, newsreels, those kinds of things, lots of music. So I guess it depends on what I'm teaching.
I think that you should take history in the human environment because you get exposure to a discipline of history that really of the courses that we offer is the newest discipline. So environmental history has, although the environment has clearly been around forever, the actual study of the environment and the impact that it has on human history is a field that's relatively new. I think students really benefit from taking the particular tools that they learn from the environmental history course as they then can go out and apply them to any of the other subjects that they're going to study. And it becomes an enriching way to sort of look at things from a different perspective, to kind of shift. We're always looking at history as, you know, the human beings that are interacting are in the front, and nature kind of serves as a backdrop. And what the environmental history allows you to do is to say, well, what happens if nature were telling the story? So how do we look at the same stories, but from a completely different perspective that gives us a much better, bigger picture? How you live is determined by where you live. And so at the very beginning of the class, students, we talk about this idea. How have you been formed and shaped by the particular environment that you've lived in? For most of us, that's a struggle. We think it has no impact. And so the initial reaction is to say it doesn't affect anything. But then as we sort of pick it apart, we learn more about it. We realize how much we've been shaped by that environment. And then what the study of environmental history does is it allows us to look at each society and to say, why do these people either achieve the things that they did? When there's a downfall, when societies collapse, what were the factors that contributed to the collapse, and how did the environment shape that? I think that that idea of how you live determines, or how you live is determined by where you live, is a central idea that goes throughout all of it and that students walk away with and say that they'll kind of forever keep thinking about.
We're back on AC Second as this episode of Past and Presence continues at AC 209. This is the office of our other Americanist, AnneMarie Kooistra, who teaches in the Western Humanities Program, teaches our senior seminar, and then a variety of classes on U.S. history, including a very popular J-term class on history of the American West and our class on constitutional history. While we're down here, I thought I'd give you a little bit of history of the history department. One office down was the longtime office of Kevin Craig, a very popular ancient medieval historian. Now it's the office of Andy Bramson, who's a political science professor. One of Andy's classes is on the history and politics in Africa, and that's one of those cross-listed classes. You can take that for both political science and history credit. This also used to be the location of something called Doc's Corner for a long time, back when Doc Dalton was the professor down here. Long before we had Royal Grounds and Sodexo and Caribou Coffee, this is where you could go grab a cup of coffee and maybe have a cookie. Maybe a simpler time in Bethel's history. But a kind of spirit of fellowship in the department that we've tried to preserve by just having this very simple gathering space down here. So it's a place you might get together to do studying or writing with other history students. Okay, let's pick up our conversation with our faculty about the nature of what it is that historians do.
So I think lots of people actually do things with the past, including some of our colleagues in other disciplines. For example, at the beginning of the John Fia book, he quotes from Gordon Wood, an American historian, who says, anthropologists use the past, economists, political scientists, genealogists use the past. To an extent, accounting is a kind of use of certain past data. What's different about what historians do with the past? Is there something about the discipline of history, the methods we use? Is it getting back to this kind of story versus science distinction that you drew at the beginning?
Yeah, I of course think that history, I mean, that's why I read history, is because I like the stories. And so for me, the stories can be inspiring because, you know, that shows me what there is to do and how we've maybe failed in the past or where we've succeeded in the past. So it's not, I feel like in those other disciplines, it's a lot of times data collecting. Mm-hmm. And I'd say doesn't inspire me about history. Mm-hmm. I mean, some data collecting is inspiring because it's, you know, the challenge of certain kinds of data collecting. But then using it to construct a powerful story, powerful narrative, that to me is what makes me different from an accountant.
Yeah, I think history always history forces you to never forget the personal aspects of it, that's sort of what you always have to remember. And I think that emphasis on history, whether it's in any of those different disciplines, history to me also always injects a humility into any of the work that you're doing, because as you were saying about the notion of it calls us to remember our successes and our failures, it's always weighing between those two. So to me, that kind of gives a sense of humility or humbleness that I don't know, I feel like that's history's job. It's to sort of keep you in your place, you know?
Well, I think a way of thinking about that, maybe especially with the social sciences, is there's a degree to which it's a utilitarian approach to the family. You do it because maybe it helps predict things. Maybe it gives you a better understanding of behavior. Or maybe, as we often hear about history, you learn lessons. Mm-hmm. But what do you think about that? I hear this all the time from entering students, is the chief reason you study the past historically, I guess, is that you learn lessons from it and you can avoid mistakes that have been made before, but I hear you saying maybe we should be humble. Does that suggest that maybe we should be humble about our ability to learn lessons from the past as well?
Well, I think it reminds us to be humble. I mean, something I always say to students is, okay, we all had the experience of a grandparent or somebody who's maybe two generations older than us saying something and we feel horrified by it. We think, I can't believe you think that way. I can't believe people thought that. I can't believe people did that. To me, we have to have this humility in that, yes, we can learn lessons, but a lot of times we don't, and history also proves that we don't. So we have to remember that 20 years from now, 30 years from now, 40 years from now, your grandchildren are going to be sitting and are going to be holding you accountable to the same thing, and they're going to be embarrassed by you and cringe at things that your generation either did or did not do. And then to me, the challenge is to say, then let's identify right now what we think we are doing wrong, or what we think 30 years from now we're going to be judged for. So...
Yeah, and I think that's something that in this book, The First Thanksgiving, in the introduction, he talks a lot about that history shows us that we are such a small part of a much, much longer story. So there's a way in which that understanding your small place in it is also a way of cultivating humility. But that's, again, I don't mean to be all preachy, but it's also where it's important to think about. So what does it mean to be a Christian in this as well? Because at the same time that I'm only a small piece of a much larger story, I'm also bearing God's image in this moment.
In this
too.
Moment. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, being attuned to flaws and ways to do better.
Yeah, and I think that that is a constant challenge, is to figure out what's my responsibility for now when you do know that it's so small, but at the same time, keeping in mind, but what's my responsibility for the future, and that our actions do have, they do carry a legacy to them. And so how are we paving the way, and also not just paving the way, but also helping to do road improvements on what has already been worn down.
Very, very nice metaphor.
Yeah.
So, Amy Poppinga and AnneMarie Kooistra, thanks for kicking us off. We'll see a lot more of you later as the semester goes on.
We're to the end of our first episode of Past and Present. So hope you've enjoyed this format and looking forward to more. We're going to conclude our tour of AC Second. As we continue the series, we're actually going to broaden out more to other parts of Bethel and then beyond Bethel to some of its former sites, other places in the Twin Cities, and well beyond, and kind of make Minnesota our classroom. It's a theme that really stuck with me when Professor Sam Mulberry, one of our colleagues, and I taught a class in the history of World War I in Europe. This is an every other year J-term trip that Sam and I offer. So if you're interested, you can learn more from us. We'll be going again in January 2017. But again, it's a nice way of helping to remind us of this fusion of past and present. When you're in Europe, World War I is 100 years away, but it doesn't really seem that distant. You still get that sense of how it impacts people in places like Belgium, France, and Germany. You're not actually going to get to see an interview with me in this webisode series, so I thought we'd close with a very brief tour over my shoulder of my office. This is AC 212. Probably what strikes out, what stands out most is the cardboard cut of Homer Simpson. It was an office-warming gift from my sister when I first showed up at Bethel in the fall of 2003. You'll get to learn more about me, students, as you take class. So we'll see you all on Monday night, and the rest of you will see you in our next webisode as Past and Presence continues. Thanks for watching. Black baby.